Day Street Books and Harper Audio present The Office BFFs.
Tales of the Office from two best friends who were there.
Written and read by Jenna Fischer.
And Angela Kinsey.
What are we doing?
I thought we had to talk fancy.
I think maybe we're just supposed to talk like ourselves.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm very sure.
Oh, okay, fine.
Hi, you guys. We are so excited to read our book to you.
And we have some fun folks who will be popping in as well.
Starting off with Creed Bratton.
As you probably know, Creed is a wonderful musician, and we asked if he would write us a song for our audiobook.
Hit it, Creed.
Here's a tall tale, you could call it a yarn, about the office ladies and the show they spawned. They took our story and wrote it all down. Little Angela and her friend Pom, Jenna and Ange, Pumpkin and Pam, go together like eggs and spam. Their book's real cute, Rudy Toot Toot, Jenna and Ange, and which one's Pam?
Ah, oh,
I loved it.
It was the perfect way to start.
Really was.
Now for another special treat, written and read exclusively for the audiobook, a foreword by one of our favorite tall fellas, Rainn Wilson.
We asked Rainn to write this foreword because, from the beginning, our friendship has annoyed Rainn a great deal. This is mostly because our friendship involved a lot of early morning chatting, in the hair and makeup trailers and first thing on set. Rainn found this grating.
All true. However, Rainn is also one of our dearest friends, and most supportive, and we were very curious what he might say when asked to reflect on our best friendship. He warned us his foreword was, quote, a little bit edgy. So buckle in, folks. Here's Rainn Wilson.
Office Ladies Foreword. When Jenna and Angela begged me, tears streaming down their telegenic faces, to write a foreword for their book, I realized there was a tremendous challenge that lay before me, a challenge unlike any I had ever faced before. The Office Ladies podcast has generated a legion of rabid fans, and for good reason. Their adoration for the chirpy, genial hosts, the aforementioned Fisher and Kinsey, is awesome, inspiring, and truth be told, just a little bit weird. This puts me, Rainn Wilson, in a bit of a pickle. And I'm not talking about Pam's Pickles, the failed pickle company Jenna launched in 2009, which ended in scandal and a suspicious warehouse fire. You see, I adore these two office ladies. They're like the sisters I never had. Jenna and Angela are rays of light, beaming forth positivity, humor, and many apologies for the tired, sexist, and dated early 2000s reference, a kind of middle-aged mom, cougar-like sexuality that can, frankly, be overwhelming at times. We're talking straight-up cougar town. And I don't mean the failed Courtney Cox sitcom that ended in scandal and a suspicious warehouse fire. But my fear, my very real fear, is that if I tell the truth about them, if I speak my truth about these besties, their fan base will recoil, seethe, and yes, eventually lash out, both online and in person. If I choose to speak out what I know to be true, I fear for my literal life and my figurative one. So I will not. I have zero desire to get canceled over revealing the grotesque underbelly of this, for lack of a better word, friend cast, or pod ship, or book pod, friend book, podcast, ship, book, whatever you call it. I don't know. Doesn't matter. So for my safety, I will begrudgingly toe the official Office Ladies party line. Here goes. The Office Ladies podcast is so funny. The hosts are so delightful. The insight and humor they provide is essential for any office fan. In listening to their episodes, not only have I gleaned information about the show I participated in for 10 years, I learn episode by episode a little eensy teensy bit about myself, about my very soul. So when they showed me their book, The Office BFFs, I was intrigued. I thought, what more do these two have to say? As it turns out, a lot. These MILFs have triumphed once again. Stories of their friendship are mixed with in-depth analysis of our beloved TV show, the likes of which have never been heard before. Their tales of red carpet fiascos, pumping breast milk in their trailers, and their somewhat tedious recounting of every single holiday we ever celebrated as a cast will leave you feeling rejuvenated and inspired. This is a great book to keep by your toilet. Their prose is annoyingly charming, chipper, and chews away at any cynicism you might have. Seriously, after I read it, I gave myself a hug. Cue record scratch sound cue. I don't know how to make that sound cue. Oh, no, stop. Oh, I can't take it anymore. I simply cannot continue with this torrent of lies. Office ladies, they're no ladies. Office BFFs, they barely know each other. This book, it's filled with crap that never happened. These grotesque succubi have ruined more than enough lives, and it's time for them to get exposed once and for all. That's what she said. Number one, Angela owes me $1,347.88, money she borrowed from me in 2011 in order to bail her cousin out of jail for, and I'm quoting from the police report, an obscene act with a gazebo. Number two, that whole Dwight putting sprinkles the cat into the freezer subplot from The Office? That wasn't fiction. That actually happened. And it was homicidal Jenna who did it. And it was based on my cat, Sniffles. True story. I would often bring Sniffles into work and keep him in my trailer. Jenna loved that darn cat. So when I had to fly to New York to shoot a commercial for Del Taco, of course I let her cat sit. Why wouldn't I? Long story short, got back to town, heard some sob story about Sniffles accidentally eating some expired pickles, and then got delivered a dead cat popsicle in a Ziploc bag by none other than Jenna Jeffrey Dahmer Fisher. Number three, Angela killed Oscar. I mean, if she hasn't yet, she probably will. It's just a matter of time. Number four, the two of them mocked Steve Carell so much right to his face that he was forced to leave the show several seasons earlier than the rest of the cast. That's why he really left. Their incessant emotional bullying of him was completely overlooked by the authorities at NBC and took a devastating psychological toll on him. To this day, he can't say the word Angela or even Angel without breaking down into gasping, snot-ridden sobs. You've all seen Carell's nose, so you know that's a lot of snot. Number five. This is the most explosive of all my revelations, and one that will rock Office fandom to the core. Jenna and Angela are so simple-minded that within 3 days of shooting the Office pilot, they became confused and believed they actually were two women named Pam Beesly and Angela Martin, shooting an actual documentary in Scranton, Pennsylvania. All of us in the cast and crew were in shock that these two seemingly normal actresses could be so suggestible and empty-headed as to lose track of their own identities. However, the footage we were getting with them was so hilarious that all of us huddled together and made a secret pact. We would allow Pam and Angela to believe their incredibly idiotic delusion. All the scripts we'd had were thrown out, which was fine because the writers were useless anyway. Instead, I and the rest of my castmates simply interacted with Pam and Angela, having real spontaneous moments. Then, after 9 years, the guilt weighed too heavily upon us, and we broke down and told Jenna Fischer and Angela Kinsey, the truth. So, In a sense, The Office really was a documentary. Real moments shared between skilled actors like myself and two oblivious, impossibly idiotic women. While it may disappoint you podcast listeners to know your heroes could be such misguided dum-dums, I hope you take solace in the fact that when you see emotional moments on The Office between Dwight and Angela or Dwight and Pam, the feelings you see me express for them are very real. Jenna, Angela, I love you both. Everyone else from The Office? Not so much. Wilson out. Please don't hurt me. Hashtag RIP Sniffles.
Wow.
Yeah.
That was,
Well, huh. We did tell him he could say anything.
For the record, I believed in Pam's pickles.
I know you did, and I've always appreciated your support on that.
You're welcome. We are so grateful to Creed and Rainn for helping us kick off our audiobook.
We're going to have more folks popping in to help us out. Oscar Nunez, Brian Baumgartner, Ellie Kemper, Steve Carell, Ed Helms, Kate Flannery, and Jennifer Garner.
What a cool lineup! Look at us go!
Well, on with the show. Dedication. For our families, Lee, Weston, and Harper.
Josh, Isabel, Jack, and Cade, we love you all so much. Introduction.
I'm Jenna Fischer.
And I'm Angela Kinsey.
We were on The Office together.
And we're best friends.
We are also moms, business partners, podcasters, lovers of knickknacks, sometime hikers, avid scrapbookers, and wine and canvas artists. And now, we are the co-authors of this book.
If you are listening to this, that means you bought our book. Thank you. If we could hug you, we would. We are huggers.
We are.
Yes.
We're going to hug you.
I'm hugging you.
This is an audible hug.
Yes, this is us hugging you. Between producing a weekly podcast, multiple Target runs, and getting snacks for the kids, do your kids snack as much as ours do? You might wonder, why did these busy ladies add writing a book to their list? I'll tell you. In April 2018, Jenna and I both decided to do a big spring cleaning of our garages, attics, basements, and sheds. Basically, all the places where we stash random stuff. Both of us had been putting off this task for years, so we decided to do it together. While digging through our boxes, we found tons of office memorabilia, journals of our time on set, piles of photos of everybody and everything, and little mementos we had collected along the way. I also found out that I apparently hoard baskets. I had 32 of them. Jenna hoards old lamps that no longer work. But that's a story for our next book, Baskets and Old Lamps, Tales of Two Ladies Who Hoard. Finding our office treasures sparked lots of memories and gave us the idea to start our weekly podcast, Office Ladies, which we launched in October 2019. We'd had a great time rewatching the show and breaking down episodes each week, but what about all of our amazing photos and our other best friend stories? Rather than keep these wonderful items to ourselves, we decided to use them to create a book.
This book is several things: a scrapbook, a BFF journal, and a love letter to fans of our show. We like to think that if something happened back then, one of us documented the moment. We couldn't be more excited to share our memories, photos, stories from life on set of The Office, and details of our friendship of more than 18 years.
Our first challenge was figuring out how to write this book together. Well, folks, we love a good chat. During our writing sessions, I would start a story and then Jenna would jump in with her memories and vice versa. So, get a cozy chair and curl up with us because we are going to share our memories with you the best way we know how. By chatting back and forth, as BFFs do.
And, thanks to this book, our garages are now clean and ready to fill with more stuff. Angela has already started collecting new baskets. I'm telling you, the woman can't pass a basket without buying it. If you really want to make her heart sing, send her a gift that comes in a beautiful basket. It's like you're giving her two gifts. Anyway, we really hope you like our book. We worked hard on it. That's what she said. Chapter 1. job opening, office work.
In 2003, a group of strangers had one very big thing in common. We had all just been cast on a new TV comedy pilot called The Office. After years of living as struggling artists, we were all very happy to be employed and doing what we loved. We could never have predicted the impact it would have on the rest of our lives.
I have an old photo from my first day of work on The Office. It was taken when Steve Carell, John Krasinski, Rainn Wilson, BJ Novak, David Denman, Phyllis Smith, and I met with the producers, network executives, showrunner Greg Daniels, and director Ken Kwapis to do a table read of the pilot script for the very first time. Allison Jones, our casting director, came to the table read armed with a plate of homemade chocolate chip cookies and a Polaroid camera. I desperately wanted a picture to commemorate the day, and this was before everyone had cameras on their phones. So I was excited when she told us all to gather together for a photo. I asked if she would take one for me, too. She said sure, took a second picture, and handed me the Polaroid and a cookie. I remember standing and munching the cookie while watching the photo slowly develop before my eyes. To let you know how special this whole moment was, let me share a little about my backstory. I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri. From the time I was 7 years old, I knew I wanted to be an actor. I can't say why exactly, but I barely remember a time when this wasn't my goal. At age 9, I considered becoming a veterinarian, but when I learned I would have to do surgeries on animals, I went back to my original plan of actor. My parents were very supportive, but also refused to let me act professionally as a child. And it's not like there were a ton of opportunities in St. Louis, to be honest. They told me I had to graduate from high school and college before moving to Los Angeles. So I auditioned for every school play and joined every drama club. I spent most of high school in the dancing chorus until my senior year when I was cast as the fiddler in The Fiddler on the Roof. I had no lines, but extra solo dancing. I went to college at a small liberal arts school in rural Missouri called Truman State University and majored in theater. I learned a lot about acting technique, and my love of performing was solidified. After graduation, I packed up my Mazda 323 hatchback and drove across the country to Los Angeles, ready to give it a go in Hollywood. I ended up spending years in various odd jobs trying to pay off my defaulted credit card and make my rent. Thanks to a mandatory typing class in high school, most of the jobs I found were working as, wait for it, a receptionist. In the meantime, I was going on hundreds of auditions and performing Commedia dell'arte with a local theater company. I earned my Screen Actors Guild card doing background work, experience that would come in handy later, as you will learn in this book, and each year I seemed to do a little better than the year before. I booked some guest appearances on television shows, a couple of independent films, and a pilot called Rubbing Charlie. Yes, you heard that right. It was a comedy starring a stressed-out doctor named Charlie, played by Scott Wolf, who gets life lessons from his massage therapist, me. I actually rubbed Charlie. It was a really sweet and funny show. I was convinced it would be my big break. So when it didn't make it past the pilot stage, I was crushed. I told my manager I wanted to quit, the years of rejection having taken their toll, and my new plan was to apply to vet technician school, animal care with no surgeries. She told me to keep at it, that the right role would find me if I just didn't give up. I had my doubts. At that point, I'd been plugging away in Los Angeles for nearly 8 years, but I decided to take her advice and give it one more year. As fate would have it, the following pilot season, I was asked to audition for the American remake of a BBC show called The Office. The role was for the receptionist, Pam, a worn-down yet still hopeful young woman with artistic dreams beyond her depressing day job. In other words, me. After we snapped the shot, Steve Carell said, "One day this photo will be worth money, especially after they fire me and replace me with a new actor for episode 2. You'll all look at this and say, aw. Remember Steve, what's his name? He was sweet. I wonder what he's up to now." Before The Office, Steve had the most experience of all of us. He wasn't a household name by any means, but he had been a correspondent on The Daily Show. He'd been a regular on The Dana Carvey Show, and he'd had a scene-stealing role opposite Jim Carrey in the movie Bruce Almighty. He had also been rejected by...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.